Good morning. Good morning. We are about to get started. If you could take your seats, we would appreciate it. Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our 2023 National Town Hall. This is the kickoff session to get us down to business for ALC 52. I'm Nicole Austin Hillary, and I have the privilege and honor of serving as the president and CEO of the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation. I am so happy to see all of you here this morning. It tells me that our theme this year of securing our democracy, protecting our freedoms, and uplifting our culture got through to everyone. You all are here to get down to business. So thank you. This is an especially compelling year for us. We know that every year we have challenges and work to do for the Black community. But this year, because of deeply threatening times that we are in, we know that despite the fact that this is the oldest democracy on the planet, we have some major challenges. Our constitutional republic has not been more at risk since the Civil War, which was 160 years ago. The attacks on our democracy are happening on all fronts. Our freedoms and our culture are coming from a number of places in terms of the people who want to attack it and who, in fact, want to hold us back. These attacks are grounded in, frankly, and I'm going to be real truthful, a racist view of America. And they all depend on misinformation and often downright deceit. As most of you know, this summer, the Congressional Black Caucus and its members, along with the Congressional Black Caucus Institute, hosted a series of town hall meetings and discussions to help mobilize and train in over 10 cities across the nation, where they discussed the most pressing matters of concern to the Black community and to deal with the issues of racial equity. And it all kicked off when Chairman Horsford of the Congressional Black Caucus held a Democracy and Race Summit early in the year, because he sent out a call to action and he said, we've got work to do, we've got to have serious discussion for these serious times, and the town hall discussions were the follow-up from that. He said we were going to put words into action, and that's what was done. So today we're going to take everything that was learned from those discussions, everything we heard from community members, and we're going to take it a step further with you all here with us today. This National Town Hall is a culmination of democracy for the people, which is what those summer town hall series were concerned. And it is in partnership with the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation that we seek to continue these conversations, and not just the conversations, but the work. As I've been saying since yesterday when we started, everyone looks beautiful at ALC. You all do. I wish you could see what I see. You look beautiful. But not only is it necessary for you to look beautiful, it's important for you to take your smarts, your strategies, and put them into action. We are here to get down to business and to walk away with a game plan. So we have an array of smart experts who are going to be talking to you today and talking with you and hearing from you. These are thought leaders from around the country, policymakers, stakeholder partners. Over the next couple of hours with us, and it's going to go fast, but bear with us. I know we've got work to do, but we are going to spend these next 2 hours in separate panels. We're going to have two separate panels, and these leading intellectuals are going to talk to you and engage with you around these issues that I've just articulated. Now, the first panel is going to be about race and racial equity. I know that's a lot, but we're going to get down to it in that conversation. And the second panel is about the threats to our democracy. And we know that's a lot of things. We're talking about the threat to voting, the threat to education, health disparities, all of affirmative action, all of the things that we are dealing with right now. Now, in addition to those two panels, we will hear from a number of special guests who are here with us to deliver some messages. These are outstanding Black leaders who are taking it upon themselves to define and disarm these threats. So it's not just about legislative leaders doing this work. It's not just about the foundation doing the work that we do around policy and research and the work that you do. It's about all of us stepping up to the plate and using what we have in front of us. We all are change makers, everyone in this room, and we all have an obligation. So it is about what each of us can do. So, without further ado, to help set the stage for this critically important discussion at today's town hall discussion, I would like to welcome to the stage the chairperson of our Congressional Black Caucus Foundation Board, the Honorable Terry Sewell, who represents the 7th Congressional District in Alabama. Please welcome her to the stage.
Thank you. Good morning. On behalf of the 38 members of the Board of Trustees for the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, I want to welcome you to ALC, or should I say, hashtag ALC52. Really excited about this. I want to acknowledge the board of directors that are in the audience. If they would please stand, if you're a board member of the CBCF, please stand. Thank you so much for attending. I'd like to also acknowledge my colleagues from the Congressional Black Caucus. Will the colleagues from Congressional Black Caucus please stand to be acknowledged? We start with our fearless leader, Stephen Horsford from Nevada, Stacy Plaskett from Virgin Islands, Bonnie Watson Coleman from New Jersey, and of course, Senator Warnock from the great state of Georgia. Thank you all for being here. It was in my hometown of Selma, Alabama, where John Lewis and the foot soldiers of the Civil Rights Movement marched, fought, bled on a bridge in my hometown for the right and freedoms that we all enjoy. But today we know that old battles have become new again, and our progress is under attack. Across the nation, extremists are fanning the flames of racism and disinformation and misinformation to strip away our freedoms, erase our culture, and undermine our democracy. We see these new attacks every day, whitewashing our history, removing stories from our textbooks, restricting our right to vote, and the list goes on and on. I am beyond concerned. I am, and I know you are, alarmed. We are truly at an inflection point in American society. In the face of these attacks, we as Americans are called upon to speak up, to stand up, and to take action. Our first panel this morning tackles racism head on. The theme of our first panel is race and racial equity. We will hear about the attempts to erase our history, to roll back affirmative action, and to erode the good faith efforts to increase diversity and inclusion in all walks of life. Our second panel is called Democracy, What Next? In that panel, we will discuss the relentless attacks on our most sacred and fundamental right, and that is the right to vote. Our vote is our voice. In the words of John Lewis, it is the most powerful nonviolent tool in our democracy. And yet, across the nation, extremists are waging the most coordinated effort to restrict voter access in a generation. Together, we will address these issues head on and explore the steps we must take to fight back. Because every generation must fight, every generation must fight. In the words of Coretta Scott King, struggle is a never-ending process. Freedom is never really won. You earn it and win it in every generation. Her words remind us of the need to be vigilant. After all, our freedoms can be fleeting if we do not protect them. The threats that we as Black Americans are facing are real and they are pernicious. But they are not coming from overseas. No. Instead, these threats are coming from our fellow citizens, just as they have for the past 400 years. Old battles have indeed become new again, but I know for a fact that if we join together, we can and we will win. But it is going to take our collective action, and yes, in the words of John Lewis, it's going to take us getting into some what? Good trouble. Good trouble, necessary trouble. Victory is far from assured, but we're not without resources. We have the intellectual, the organizational, and political power to fight back. That power is largely in your hands. Everyone has a role to play. So pay close attention, because today we will be discussing the actions that must be taken on the ground in our communities across this nation to secure our democracy, to protect our freedoms, and to uplift our culture. And now it is my great pleasure to introduce a man who has devoted his life to the fight and who has spoken powerfully for racial justice, both from the pulpit and now from the United States Congress, none other than Georgia Senator Raphael Warnock.
Well, good morning, everybody. I'm a Baptist preacher. Good morning, everybody. Listen, it's wonderful to be here. I am deeply honored. Thank you so very much, Congresswoman Sewell from Selma, Alabama. We welcome all to our ALC town hall, securing our democracy, protecting our freedoms, uplifting our culture. We have to do all of these things, and all of those goals are inextricably connected. I'm thrilled to be co-chairing the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation's 52nd Annual Legislative Conference alongside my partner, Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett. Give her a great big round of applause. Virgin Islands in the house. Listen, our annual legislative conference is a call to action. We'll have a lot of conversations this week, but it's important to remember that this is a call to action, fortified by thought-provoking discussion, collaborative brainstorming on policy solutions, and purposeful action that can be applied to communities across the country. That's what this town hall, that's what this family reunion is all about, a call to action, and it could not come at a more important time. This is a moral moment in our country, and we are called upon again to push the nation to center equity in all of its discussions and all of its policy, and to move forward the continuing project of democracy. And black folk have always had to play a particular kind of role in that work because we've been on the underside of that conversation, somewhere a nation caught between being and becoming, a democracy yet to be. We are the ones who've had to push that conversation. And we know this from history. I know it from personal experience. Don't take the fact that I won in the state of Georgia. Do not take the fact that I won in the state of Georgia as a clue or a cue to be lulled into sleep. Don't misread what happened in Georgia. In fact, some folks studied our win and they went after it with surgical precision. As we entered the runoff the second time, they saw us win the runoff the first time. They said, they're not going to let them do that again. And as we entered the runoff this year, officials in Georgia said there will be no voting on the first Saturday of the runoff. They were literally misreading an old Georgia law saying it was a Saturday after a holiday, holiday being Thanksgiving, and you can't make this up, the other holiday, an old holiday in Georgia that honored Confederate General Robert E. Lee. Said, you can't vote. And Secretary of State said, I'm sorry, it's the letter of the law, our hands are tied. And so I decided to untie their hands, I sued them. And then after I sued them, the folk who said their hands were tied then showed us their hands. They went and appealed the ruling. And so in a matter of days, we had to sue them again and win again, just so people could vote the first weekend of the runoff. And that first weekend, about 100,000 people voted, which, by the way, was about the margin of my victory. We are witnessing an assault on our democracy. And so we need the Congressional Black Caucus to continue the work that we've always done. Nothing could be more important. Nothing could be more precious. Reinhold Niebuhr was right. Humankind's capacity for justice makes democracy possible. Our capacity for injustice makes democracy necessary. Democracy, I believe, is the political enactment of a spiritual idea that all of us have within ourselves, a spark of the divine. And therefore, we ought to have a voice, and the way to have a voice is to have a vote in the direction of the country and our destiny within it. I believe that a vote is a kind of prayer for the world we desire for ourselves and for our children. And so we are not about to give up on this fight, which is why we introduced the Freedom to Vote Act earlier this year. And we're determined to get it over the finish line. We'll continue to fight for the John Lewis Act. We'll continue to fight the good fight. And once again, we got to save the country. Those who have been on the underside of this story, who've pushed the country closer to its ideals. Thomas Jefferson said, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, among them life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." You stand there in the Jefferson Memorial and you think about those words. Right across the basin, there is a black man facing Thomas Jefferson named Martin Luther King Jr., looking in Thomas Jefferson's direction with his arms folded as if to say, "Did you mean what you said when you said what you said?" That's the story of the people on whose shoulders we stand. That's the work of the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, and so we look forward to this important discussion. Let's get the work done. God bless you. Keep the faith. She needs no introduction. The great Representative Stacy Plaskett, Virgin Islands.
Thank you so much. Can we give a round of applause again to Senator Warnock? I want to thank him and all of you for the fight. Good morning, everyone. As we say in my home, "Mon in." I'm honored to welcome you all to the 52nd Annual Legislative Conference of the National Town Hall, a pivotal gathering organized by the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation and the Congressional Black Caucus Institute. This event represents the culmination of Democracy for the People, which traversed over 10 cities across our nation, bringing together thought leaders, activists, policymakers, and stakeholders to confront the most pressing challenges facing Black America. Today, we gather to address the intersectionality of race and democracy and forge concrete strategies to mobilize Black Americans in the face of current threats. Now, as some of you may know, I serve as the senior Democratic member on a committee that my colleagues across the aisle established when they assumed the majority of the House of Representatives, the Select Committee on the Weaponization of the Federal Government. Now, many of my colleagues know that there's a lot of projection that go on by my colleagues across the aisle. When they point the finger at somebody else, it's because they're thinking it about themselves. This committee is indeed this generation's House Un-American Activities Committee. In response to this glaring attempt to derail the federal government's obligation to investigate and conduct due processes on actions, organizations, and individuals that threaten our republic and create an undemocratic environment I and my fellow Democratic colleagues, my colleagues on my side of the aisle, call ourselves the Truth Squad. We continue to press them to put people over the baseless theatrics from extremists. We know that that committee is being used to cause Americans to distrust the federal government, to distrust facts, to distrust the law, to distrust that when one man or a group of people are indicted, are put charges are put to them for wrongdoing, that they should be exempt from the law. We can't have that. None of you will have that. And that's why we're here today, to work together to stop that from happening. I'm pleased to serve on this panel to delve into the critical issues of racial equity, emphasizing the importance of preserving our Black history to guide our present and future. It's imperative that we draw wisdom from our past to capitalize on the opportunities in our present. We must safeguard our history to inform our path forward and ensure that the struggles, achievements, and contributions of Black Americans remain at the forefront of our collective memory. Not just our children, all children's memories. The erosion of democratic values, the rise of disinformation, ideological polarization, voter suppression, and the weakening of democratic institutions demand our unwavering attention and our fight. Now, you know, I represent the Virgin Islands. My family go back 300 years on that island, but I was raised in Brooklyn. So it's not going to get my attention, it's going to get my fight. From efforts to ban books about Black history, to ending affirmative action in higher education, and attempts to dismantle minority contracting and diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives, these relentless attacks on race and democracy continue unabated. We must stand united against these regressive measures. Now, you know, I said I like to fight, right? I like the law. I like truth. And at this national town hall, we will explore all of these things, these threats, these comprehensive, equipped participants. But when we delve into these critical discussions, when we say we are about the fight and preserving the law, there's one person I know who is about that. And it's my pleasure, great pleasure, to introduce a distinguished guest, Letitia Tish James. The 67th Attorney General of the State of New York. Attorney General James has demonstrated an unwavering commitment to justice, accountability, and the protection of vulnerable New York residents. As the first woman of color to hold statewide office in New York and the first woman elected as Attorney General, she has blazed a trail of accomplishments throughout her career and doing it with style, doing it with that New York swagger. Under her leadership, the Office of the Attorney General has secured billions in settlements from those who broke state laws and taken decisive action on issues ranging from opioid epidemic accountability to gun violence prevention, environmental protection, and defense of reproductive health care access. Attorney General James has been a national leader in the fight for reproductive rights, a champion for workplace protection, and a defender of the census and DACA. Let's not forget, dreamers are us too. They look like us too. Her dedication to justice transcends partisan lines and serves as an inspiration to us all. I thank each and every one of you for your commitment to democracy, racial equity, and the betterment of our society. Together, we can overcome the challenges before us and build a more just and inclusive future for all Americans. I want to invite Attorney General James up right now to give us a special message. Thank you all.
Good morning. Is Brooklyn in the house? Brooklyn. Glenn. They just walked in. It's great to be with all of you this morning. And I want to thank the CBC Foundation for the invitation, this invitation to this very important event. And of course, I want to thank my very good friend, Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett from the Virgin Islands for that kind introduction. And she does hail from Brooklyn. And when I think about her serving on the committee, the weaponization of the federal government, I can't help but think about the weaponization of the federal government, and in particular, some members of Congress who've weaponized government, who've engaged in an intentional act to deprive individuals of food, individuals who failed to address child poverty. That's the weaponization of the government. Individuals who failed to address the mass incarceration of people of color. Members of Congress who unfortunately failed to address homelessness. If you want to talk about the weaponization of the federal government, let's start there. I cannot thank you enough for calling this national town hall, especially for your first panel focusing on the malevolent and coordinated attacks on racial equity. Whether it is through systemic attacks on our right to vote or the ending of affirmative action on the college campuses, our tax dollar supports and where children attend, and now similar attacks at our places of employment, including DEI policies and programs. I want to recognize the members of the Democratic members who are attorney generals, and specifically the black members who are now attorney generals all across this nation. There are now six of us. And Congresswoman Plaskett, we formed a caucus. And it's led by my very good friend from Nevada, Aaron Ford. So now that there are all of these attacks, including DEI, where, again, the Democratic Attorney Generals, we wrote a letter to all of the major corporations in this country talking about the benefits of DEI. We also told them that the erasure of black history in our public school systems was an abomination, and replacing it with demeaning and untrue and far-right propaganda masquerading as history basically was totally inconsistent with the facts. And I believe in my heart of heart that facts will come back into being one day very soon. I know that individuals have been banning books by acclaimed black authors and other minority voices all across this nation. And so we as a people and individuals who are our allies, we must not only push back against this racist and malicious assault on the worth of our citizenship, we must stamp it out altogether. I am a lifelong advocate for social and racial justice, and I am an attorney personally and professionally committed to equal justice under the law, recognizing that the law should be used both as a sword and as a shield. It is my responsibility to continue to protect the rights of New Yorkers, but most importantly, those who are vulnerable and those who are marginalized in the great state of New York. And as a black woman and as the chief legal officer of one of the largest and most diverse states in the nation, I watch all of this unfold with a sense of outrage and growing concern. It is clearly part of a much larger effort to transform this vibrant and dynamic democratic country into an ethno-nationalist authoritarian state. This right-wing push has been compared with what we have seen with the emergence of regressive governments in Turkey and Hungary. And I would say that there are also shades of apartheid, South Africa. And so it must be resisted with everything that we have. with all of our being, with every element of our soul. The attacks on programs that acknowledge race and racism are a clear effort to erase a chapter of American history, our history, to re-engineer facts. And it's important that the injustices of the past not be forgotten. You see, it becomes so much easier to block efforts to address the inequalities of the present than to address them with the facts. Because we know what we have been through. We know where we have come from. And we know what it takes to get our community and our society to where we are today. It has been a relentless effort to build a society rooted in racial, social, and economic justice, not for some, but for all. And the challenges continue to this day. It has been a generation-long struggle to create a nation that truly reflects a representative democracy worthy of its people. And so just as the freedom fighters and warriors for civil rights and all of the heroes and sheroes that we know face strong pushback from the forces of hate and regression, all of those forces out there who unfortunately are responding to the fact that we had our first black president, we now confront a new generation of those committed to rolling back programs who unfortunately failed to even recognize President Barack Hussein Obama. In fact, we see an active effort to impose second-class citizenship status on black Americans once again, to roll back the clock of progress, to roll back our efforts to vote, to deny our freedoms, to surgically target those in communities all across this nation. And since we know what we are facing, we all carry the responsibility of standing up to it and speaking truth to power and putting some steel in your backbone. Whoa. And walking into those courtrooms, or walking on those protest lines, or standing up to someone who refuses to see your humanity, and with all the fiber, with all of your being, with all of the ancestors who flow through your DNA, you need to tell them the truth. And that is why I am so grateful and so honored for the CBC Foundation-sponsored National Town Hall. And that is why I will be honored when I walk into that courtroom on October 2nd to hold someone responsible, to hold someone accountable, well, my role is civil, but I will come back before you soon with a check for $250 million. And to let you know that he is no longer allowed to do business in the state of New York. Yeah, we've got a special charge to show up and stand up for one another and to remember all of those who are struggling under the weight of poverty. And although we look very beautiful today and this is a wonderful event, the reality is that our brothers and sisters are out there struggling each and every day, and we must never forget them. Don't get caught up in all of your titles. Don't get caught up in all of the benefits of serving an office. Remember, we are there to serve and not to be served. Remember, we've got to stand up for children living in poverty, stand up for the legacy of endurance and persistence and love given to us by our ancestors, standing up for the future of this country, stand up and defend freedom and democracy and liberty and equity and justice and inclusion. So I encourage all of you, my dear hearts, to never lose hope and to keep fighting. Because as Dr. King once said, there are no broad highways to lead us easily and inevitably to quick solutions. We must keep going. We must keep fighting. All of you in this room are essential to making progress essential and possible. And I want to thank the members of CBC Foundation for this opportunity to speak. And of course, I must give a shout out to my Congress member and my friend and the next speaker of the United States Congress, Hakeem Jeffries. Yes. Because he knows, like I know, that all roads lead to Brooklyn.
Please welcome back to the stage, Nicole Austin Hillary.
If you didn't know before, you know now, okay? You know now. We are ready and fired up. I wanted to also let you know, as I said in my introductory remarks, the work does not stop here. We expect everyone to take these marching orders and go forward. Another thing that we invite you to do with us today following this dynamic discussion is to join us in the exhibit hall on the main stage. For the first time, we are going to be having an ALC spotlight. It will be a fireside chat talking about the fight and the threats on diversity, equity, and inclusion. We know that, again, you've heard this morning, it is a battle, and we have to continue that discussion. Simone Sanders of MSNBC will be hosting this fireside chat, and we will be joined by experts. So when you leave here, get your lunch and come back for the Exhibit Hall 2:30 fireside chat. And I also, before we move on to our panels, want to recognize that we have now been joined by the former chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, the Honorable Joyce Beatty of Ohio. All right, we are now ready to get started. I am going to ask to come to the stage our Vice President for the Center for Policy Analysis and Research at the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, Dr. Jonathan Cox.
Good morning, everybody. Now, I'm very thrilled to have been asked to introduce our moderator for today's National Town Hall. Now, he is a man whose stature and experience are more than equal to the significance of these panels. Quite simply, with his original ideas and his unmatched ability to articulate them, he's one of America's leading public intellectuals. Somehow, he manages to combine the scholarly and the popular, citing philosophers and academics alongside hip-hop artists and comedians. He's published more than 24 books, all of them well-received and many of them bestsellers. His work has been rewarded with an American Book Award, the Southern Book Prize, and 2 NAACP Image Awards. Now, we've benefited from his insights on NPR, in the New York Times, and on such television shows as Meet the Press, Face the Nation, The Today Show, and Good Morning America. He's taught at such prestigious colleges as Brown, Columbia, Georgetown, and Vanderbilt, and the universities of North Carolina and Pennsylvania. Now, as an ordained pastor, he's well known for his forceful and engaging sermons at countless houses of worship across the country. And if you were at last year's ALC, I know you'll never forget his stern remarks as he accepted the CBC Chair's Award from Representative Joyce Beatty. Now, it's an honor and a pleasure to introduce him to you now, Dr. Michael Eric Dyson.
Give it up for Dr. Cox. And to all of the distinguished Congress people and brothers and sisters who are gathered here I know y'all ready to get down. There's a little Brooklyn love going up in here. I used to fuss when the landlord dissed us. No heat. Wonder why Christmas missed us. Birthdays was the worst days. Now we sip champagne. Damn right I like the life I live, because I went from, and if you don't know, yeah. But I'm from Detroit. Midwest, Congresswoman Joyce Beatty, what up from Ohio? My girl. Huh? So when y'all were in swaddling clothes trying to get into the inn, Detroit was dropping Aretha Franklin on you, ain't no way. Smokey Robinson was saying, I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. When it's cold outside, I got to. So Brooklyn recognized, what up though? Stevie Wonder. When you believe in things you don't understand, then you suffer. Superstition ain't the way. So while Brooklyn got a nice little niche in a postmodern existence and a post-industrial culture, Detroit established the foundations of which we rest on right now. What up? Now, but Brooklyn's a nice little brother and sister. We appreciate you. Did I mention that Tish James and I have the same birthday month and year? We just had a little sibling rivalry right there. We are honored to be here today. We're gonna get right to it. We know we are living in the midst of a crisis of imagination, a crisis of conceiving democracy yet again. We know that the forces of white supremacy, recrudescent bigotry, and the hateful articulation of an orange apparition that denies the legitimacy of our humanity, joined by Floridians who want to ban books, black bodies, and imagination. We ain't having it. That's why our ancestors poured into us. We didn't get these positions to be weak. We didn't get these positions to be complicit in the very forces of oppression which would undermine the power of what we represent. So this first panel is on race and racial equity. Why didn't we say equality? Equality means you get exactly what everybody else getting. Equity means you get what you need in order to move to a position of authority to express your gifts and talents. So we are exceedingly grateful to be here today to talk about equity, to talk about affirmative action, to talk about the erasure of our history. I mean, Frederick Douglass said that in slavery, the greatest offense black people could commit was to be asleep. Now we trying to be woke, they got a problem with it. So here we are, ending affirmative action. White America has benefited from affirmative action forever and a day. And we gonna get into that. So I'm grateful and honored to be here today. Let's get right to this panel. I want to set the stage by sharing with you some of the groundwork that the CBCF has been doing across the country all summer long. But before we do that, let's watch this video. But before we watch the video, there's an important notice I need to share with you. The Congressional Black Caucus Political Education and Leadership Institute, often referred to by its acronym CBCI, is an Internal Revenue Code Section 501c4 nonprofit, nonpartisan social welfare organization. That was for me. but we know how to get around that. CBCI primarily engages in activities that promote the common good and general welfare of people in the community. Specifically, CBCI provides community and voter education along with leadership training. Importantly, CBCI and CBCF are distinct organizations that serve distinct exempt purposes and are governed by different Internal Revenue Code laws. And if you ain't just paid your taxes, don't say nothing crazy. In conjunction with this annual legislative conference, CBCF has invited CBCI to introduce itself to our audience and to share about its charitable mission and programming. CBCF notes that the presentations made today by CBCI is expressly that of CBCI and may not and should not be considered the speech or position of CBCF. I represent Detroit. That's who I'm talking for. I represent the people. That's what it is. We recognize the limits and opposition to narrow partisanship. We are not narrow. We are not partisan. We are for the people and democracy. That's why we're going to be free to talk. Now, let's watch this video in an overview of democracy for the people.
Democracy is under attack in America right now. Not only on the attack of the U.S. Capitol on January 6th, which was an attack not just on the Capitol building, but the institution of democracy in America.
When we look at the issues that we are facing today, a truth among many is that we are looking at a full-on attack on the hard-fought, hard-won freedoms and rights that have been achieved by the people in this room and so many others that were here before us and upon whose shoulders we stand.
I want to welcome you to Democracy for the People, the Summer of Action.
As states across the country are banning books, banning our history, we have an obligation to tell those stories, to keep the conversation going, so that we are connecting with the people.
We know that when our communities are ignorant to the fact, they can succumb to misinformation and disinformation.
We know that change rarely comes from the halls of Congress. It bubbles up from grassroots activism in our communities.
Democracy is going to have to be fought for in every generation.
I proclaim, one, democracy is virtuous, it is true, it is righteous, and it is right. But I also proclaim that we're in a time that we must fight for.
And I say this, the next 18 months will determine whether or not we relive those experiences. We have to be vigilant.
The Congressional Black Caucus wants to be your partner in this work. We can't do this either by ourselves. We need you.
Now's the time that we use this. Instead of kicking rocks and being angry, let's mobilize, educate, and vote.
With that as a background, let's have a vibrant and vigorous discussion. We couldn't ask for a more distinguished group of panelists, so let me introduce them to you now. First, someone you all know, the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, Representative Stephen Horsford. Hollywood handsome, chocolate charming. One of our leading scholars, a professor at both Columbia and UCLA law schools. I mean, both coasts. She is bi-coastal, the inventor of intersectionality, and a contributor to critical race theory, the great Kimberly W. Crenshaw. Brilliant. And if I may say so, awfully gorgeous as well. The president and executive director of the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, the big man with a big plan, with a big hand, Brother Damon Hewitt. Big sexy. The CEO of the Black Economic Alliance, Yale trained, not quite Princeton, but she's still a brilliant, gifted, insightful sister, Samantha Tweedy.
And Brooklyn.
And Brooklyn. Beautiful and engaging. Finally, a founding partner and the chief operating officer of the Fearless Fund, replacing the Scared Negro Fund, Miss Ayanna Parsons. Sharp, insightful, doing your thing. Welcome to you all. You may be seated. My mic is next to my chair. I'll sit down. So let's get right to it. Representative Horsford, you're in Nevada. We do feel that we're taking a bet on democracy, and we're gambling with our future right now. But talk to us about, since we're in an overarching theme dealing with democracy and the possibility of democracy flourishing under existential threat and economic peril that our other panelists will address, talk to us more broadly in full sweep about democracy, the pillars of democracy, and why it's critical to have a conversation about race and racial equity at the heart of democratic process.
Well, thank you, Dr. Dyson. It's great to be with everybody. Welcome to the CBCF 52nd Annual National Town Hall. I want to thank all of our colleagues from the Congressional Black Caucus and, of course, Chair Sewell for your tremendous leadership of the foundation. Democracy, to me, are the institutions, the cornerstones that are made up of our public schools that are being undermined and attacked, the effort to erase our history, particularly black history, to rewrite that history and to somehow infer that enslaved people benefited or were provided some type of skills training as a result. Democracy is the cornerstone of the free press, particularly the black press, that has provided critical information now and in the past to ensure that our community does not fall victim to misinformation and disinformation. It includes the cornerstone of our courts, which in the last administration and under Senate Majority Leader, now Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, they stacked the federal judiciary and the Supreme Court, and Donald Trump asked black people in the last election, what do you have to lose? And the Supreme Court answered that when they took away women's freedom to make their own health care decisions about their body and now deny access to students to go to college. And the cornerstone of democracy to me, the most important, is that which Representative John R. Lewis and others fought for, which is our fundamental right to vote. And we, as black people, understand the efforts over our history to suppress that right, to deny that right. And that is why today the Congressional Black Caucus, with the leadership of our members, are not just pushing for the reauthorization of the Voting Rights Act under John R. Lewis, but to make sure that every black person understands their power and their agency in this moment to hold the line, to defend our democracy, to protect our race, and to make sure the next generation is better off than our current generation. That is the moment that we are in, and that is why this annual legislative conference and this national town hall are so important.
Thank you. Professor Crenshaw, let's build on Representative Horsford there. As I mentioned in your introduction, you having participated in the construction, the conceptualization, and the expression of critical race theory, we want to talk about what that even means and the misreading of it, a deliberate disinformation campaign. No better person to talk to you than you, but also you are the creator of intersectionality. I mean, scholars dream about being connected to one thing. You got two big ideas, at least, connected to your name. Talk to us about the eviscerating effect of these amnesiac politicians who want to erase history, who want to ban books, who want to limit access to knowledge, not only for African American people, but for the majority of students in this country. Talk to us about the panic at the heart of the attack on CRT, intersectionality, and on black learning and black knowledge.
Thank you so much for that question, Michael. I want to start by just painting a picture about how widespread, how deep, how threatening this attack on our knowledge, on our wisdom, on our history actually is. In this country today, there are over 23 states that have passed bans on the way Black history can be taught. They have passed bans on the way things like the Tulsa race massacre can be taught. They have passed bans on the effort to teach what segregation was really about. They have passed bans on the ability to talk in real terms, not only about the history of enslavement, but its contemporary manifestations. Nearly half of American school children today go to a school in which there are limits now used by law to limit what they can learn about this country and what they can learn about themselves. Who are they framing as the people that they're trying to protect in these efforts to suppress how we talk about our history? They're trying to say that these laws are necessary to protect the sensibilities and the feelings of white school children. What about the realities of our children? What about the fact that they are being deprived of the ability to actually understand who we are as a people, how we came here, how we survived, and what we need to know, to understand, and to be about in order to protect ourselves in this moment? This is all about redemption 2.0. And when I say redemption, I want people to remember that we've been here before. This has happened to us before. At the end of Reconstruction, we lost our right to vote. We lost our right to learn. We lost our right to advocate for ourselves. And this wasn't just about one election. When we lost the last congressman, the last Black congressman in 1901, it was 70 years before another Black congressman was elected. So we have to recognize that what we are fighting around right now, what we are fighting for right now, is not just the next election or the election after that. We're fighting for our right to be here for the rest of this century and beyond. So don't mistake this to be about a little issue about something called critical race theory. Don't mistake this to be a little issue about, well, do we talk about enslavement as an employment program giving Black folks skills? We need to understand that this is about taking away our ability to narrate our lives. It's about taking away our ability to talk about inequality. It's about our inability to talk about the continuing ways that racism shapes every aspect of our existence. If they can take away our ability to just speak the reality, how are we going to be able to transform our reality? So look, when we know that people come after something that's important to us, when they come after our vote, they come after our voices, they come after our narratives, they come after our history, they're coming after us. So it doesn't matter if the frame they put on it is critical race theory. It doesn't matter if the thing that they say they're against is wokeness. It doesn't matter if the thing that they're saying they're protecting is their feelings. Recognize they are coming after our right to say who we are, what our reality is, in order to prevent us from actually doing everything that we need to do to make our lives worthy of this democracy and to make this democracy the true multiracial democracy that we know we have a right to make it become for all of us.
Where the organ is at? Where the organ is at up in here? My God. Give it up for Reverend Dr. Professor Kimberly Crenshaw. I mean, they don't know the difference between CRT and OPP. So, Brother Hewitt, sexual chocolate. Let me ask you a question. So, when we think about Santayana, those who don't know their history are doomed to repeat it, living in what Gore Vidal called the United States of Amnesia, right? And we can say Barbara Streisand supplies the theme song, "What's too painful to remember, we simply choose to forget." It's a deliberate dismemory. It's what Hannah Arendt called a defactualization, not a creation of fact-based, truth-centered consciousness. Tell us the consequence to American democracy of denying entire swaths of our history and teaching limited aspects, even of enslavement. Now, if you want to teach skills that black people learned, killing white slave masters was one of them. Not sure that that's going to be on the agenda, right? Poisoning the water stream, sharing bodily liquids in the greens. So talk to us about the erasure of entire swaths of history and the consequence, the negative consequence that has on history, not only for black folk, but for the masses of Americans.
Well, thank you, Brother Dyson. The negative consequence, not just on history, but on our daily lives and existence.
Mm-hmm.
You heard Professor Crenshaw talk about how there are laws, like in Oklahoma, where you can't teach about the Tulsa Race Massacre. You also can't teach about the Trail of Tears,
mm-hmm.
right? Because our struggles are linked. But they're afraid of indoctrinization, so they say, but this is actually a massive effort at brainwashing, a massive effort, because the way Professor Crenshaw said it, when we look at TV, when we read books, when you watch movies, you think black folks are a whole different people than we know ourselves to be.
Yeah.
That's what our brothers and sisters from other continents say. Well, I didn't know it was like this. I didn't know who you were, because all I saw was what you saw. But they also use this revisionist history to create structures that disadvantage black folks and advantage other people who have power. So we litigated, we argued the affirmative action case in the Supreme Court. And it ain't over because there's more cases coming, and we're still litigating those too at the Lawyers Committee and other organizations. But think about legacy admissions. Think about legacy admissions. That's the functional equivalent of the grandfather clause in voting rights. Remember that? If your grandfather and them could vote, then, well, you can vote too.
Right.
Well, if your grandfather and them attended Princeton or Harvard or whatever school it was, then you can go too. And whose grandfather was able to do that? Or great-grandfather, what have you, right? So they use revisionist history to create structures that on the surface seem neutral, race neutral, power neutral, but they're anything but. And if we allow those revisionist history structures to define our reality, we are running a race with one hand tied behind our back and one knee capped out. That's how we're forced to run the race. So we have to run the race with full knowledge. You're not going to hit the road without knowing where you're going. You're not going to drive without being able to see. That's what we have to be able to do. And this whole revisionist history is designed to blind us not only to historical realities and present realities, but future possibilities. They say affirmative action and all this stuff is a handout, what have you. That's what revisionist history tells us. But real history says affirmative action, first of all, was never going to save us in its entirety. But we fought for it because we know it's not a handout. It's what we deserve to be seen for our whole and true selves. You can't look at me and say, that's just a man. You're going to look at me and say, that's a black man. That's a handsome black man. You didn't say handsome. But there are people who like to not see things. There are people who say, well, I don't see race. See, I voted for Obama. I don't see race because I voted for a black man. Yes, you see race. And it's okay. You know what? I want to be seen. I demand to be seen. And you do too. So if we can see and appreciate each other for our whole selves, we can undo this revisionist history. We can undo this effort to not just whitewash, but to brainwash us and every American in this country.
Thank you, sir. Excellent. Sister Tweedy, you named your children Stokely and Evers. So we know linguistically and in nomenclature, you have insisted upon a historical acknowledgement in the very naming of your children to extend a trajectory of emancipation, liberation, and freedom. One of the arguments made in terms of banning books, well, it makes our children uncomfortable, as Professor Crenshaw refer to that, as if discomfort is not the basis for education. If you ain't uncomfortable with your ignorance, you ain't gonna never learn. But the discomfort of white children as a bellwether and a benchmark for what is acceptable in our society. Talk to us, as a woman who's been deeply involved in both economic reconstruction and educational access. Talk to us about why it's important to fight against the banning of these books and to suggest that parents who stand against reading about Rosa Parks or reading about what happened in New Orleans are on the wrong side of history.
Absolutely. Thank you, Dr. Dyson. And what I say when people ask, well, what's going to happen to the children? How are the children going to feel? I look at them and I say, you don't have kids, do you? Mm-hmm. Because I have an 8-year-old Stokely and I have a 5-year-old Evers. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, Saturday Night Live was going to put on a skit of a woke school, that's the school my kids go to. You know, they're learning about everything from the time they're 4 years old, and I watch them. And you know what kids do? Black kids, white kids, all kids. They don't take on the past of others. They don't look at us and say, well, what did you do, mama? And what did he do out there? What they say is, this is about us. And just like when they're learning math or they're learning reading or they're learning writing or anything else, they're doing it together, not against one another. So I don't think they have kids, Dr. Dyson. But yes. What I want us to be thinking about as we're asking these questions about the pillars of our democracy is what that democracy is actually upholding. Mm. Life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. And none of that is possible, as we all know, without the economic power and freedom and opportunity to be able to actually live those lives of liberty and freedom. So as we're looking and feeling and hearing and fighting these attacks, we need to notice something. Supreme Court on affirmative action. The 13 states' attorneys general's letters telling the Fortune 100 companies cease and desist. The case brought against the Fearless Fund. Those are all cuts against economic pathways to opportunity, to progress, and to wealth building. You know, when the Emancipation Proclamation was signed, in this country, the black community held less than 1% of our nation's worth. 150 years later, after a civil rights movement, after a Reconstruction, after the national response to the murder of George Floyd, that percent of wealth held by black community in this country has budged by only 2%. So we have to ask ourselves, as we're thinking about what we're fighting back against right now, were we okay with how things looked before the affirmative action case in this country? Still, your average black graduate from college was earning less and amassing less wealth than your average white high school dropout. With all of the corporate diversity programs, DEI efforts, there is only one black woman CEO in the Fortune 500. So yes, we have to hold the floor. We also can't just fight defense right now. We have to fight offense. Mm-hmm. We can't look to rebuild what we had as if those pathways were getting us where we needed to go. We need to build pathways that are highways, that are runways, that are autobahns to economic prosperity and to wealth building. And so as we're in this conversation about what it looks like to preserve, let's just make sure we're also looking at, what does that ceiling look like? What does that North Star look like? And not let us spend all of our energy thinking about how we make sure we don't lose the floor, but that we are able to fight defense and offense at the same time, so that what we come out with for Stokely, for Evers, for all of our children, looks dramatically different than what it's looked like for any of us today.
Mm. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Very powerful. We want to recognize Representative Troy Carter from Louisiana. Okay. I think Tisha James wants me to say that he may be Jay-Z's cousin. I'm not sure. Mr. Carter. Ms. Parsons, talk to us. We've heard mention about the suing of the Fearless Fund. I love that title, Fearless Fund. It just stands for everything in one phrase that we attempt to articulate as minoritized and racialized communities. But I think about affirmative action. I think about the fact that the GI Bill built the white middle class. There would be no suburbanization without the giving of a mortgage, access to a job, and access to education. That's the Holy Trinity. And the very people who have benefited from affirmative action, think about the book When Affirmative Action Was White by Ira Katz Nelson, a Columbia University professor, to lay that out. Talk to us about the disparity in recognition and perception of the benefits that white brothers and sisters and others have received versus the relatively paltry benefits that have accrued to us, and then talk about the suing of the Fearless Fund.
Absolutely. So let me just start by saying that there are three things that make this world go round: money, power, and love. And we as black folks, we got a whole lot of love. But I'm gonna tell you what we don't have. We don't have enough power, and we damn sure don't have enough money. The reason why this suit and what we are facing as the Fearless Fund, which is the first venture capital fund founded by women of color, investing in women of color, we are the most founded demographic of entrepreneurs. The most founded. We're starting businesses at a faster rate than anyone, yet the least funded. This is about money. This is about wealth creation. This is about the American dream, and quite frankly, what Ed Blum, who has sued the Fearless Fund, is trying to do is dismantle our economic freedom and our ability to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and experience that which is the American dream. So this is so much bigger than us. We need 1,000 Fearless Funds, but most importantly, we need the capital. So let me tell you how this works in terms of the disparities. In 2022, more than $288 billion was deployed to entrepreneurs to start businesses. That is venture capital, that's seed money to start those businesses. Of that $288 billion, less than half of 1%, 0.39% to be exact, went to women of color. So black, Latina, Native, Asian American. 0.13%, let me say that again, 0.13% went to black women. So when you look at these disparities, knowing that we comprise more than 20% of the US population, yet are receiving, as black women, 0.13% of the dollars, and as women of color as a total and a collective, 0.39%. It is abysmal. And what this money allows these entrepreneurs to do, hire employees, change and transform communities. Because we know when it comes to diversity, Pew did some research years ago that suggests that 80% of white Americans in this country have networks that are 100% white. 80% of white Americans in this country have networks that are 100% white. If you are black or brown in this country, though, you are 8, 9, 10 times more likely to have completely diverse networks of all races, all ethnicities. That's why this is so important, because if you can diversify the investors, those who are writing the checks, you can diversify the investments, and we can create economic freedom and progress for all. So that, my friends, is why this lawsuit is so incredibly important. He has already taken away our affirmative action in higher education. He has already gone after board diversity legislation in California. He is coming after us. He's suing West Point now. He's suing law firms. He's going after the corporations and their DEI initiatives. So this is a very targeted and planned attack, and the time for us to fight back is now.
Amen. Amen. Not sure how much time we have left. Let's just have a round robin very quickly. When you look at the situation, starting with Representative Horsford, when you look at the situation that all of you have brilliantly described, what's the one central thing you think we need to do in order to combat the amnesia, the erosion of opportunity, the denial of history, the unfacting of black history, and how we assert ourselves, not only politically, but economically and socially?
Well, I actually want to build on what Ayanna Parsons just discussed with Who is standing in the way of this opportunity? She called out the person, Ed Blum, who's part of a larger coordinated effort behind the lawsuit against black women entrepreneurship, against students having access to college. Mm-hmm. He's also behind the effort to strike down Roe versus Wade and women having the freedoms to reproductive justice. Now, because of that quelching and bullying effect, they are now threatening corporate America. You've got people like Senator Tom Cotton telling law firms, don't promote diversity, equity, and inclusion, or we're going to come after you. And as has been stated, these are tools to address historic and systemic racism and discrimination and disparities. They were just tools. So they're the floor, they're not the ceiling. So what we need to be doing in this moment is holding the line, defending our democracy, defending against the attacks that would weaken access to opportunity, as has been discussed, but we also need to cast a larger vision for what it means to be black and what we can do based on our power economically, politically. You talked about money, power, and love. While we may not have all the money we need, we have more power than we use economically.
Mm-hmm.
We have more power if we combine the resources of our black mayors and black county executives and black state legislators and the CBC together so that we're coordinated, we have a central message, and we mobilize our people. We got to get out of Washington, D.C. and focus on where the people are. That's why we led the Democracy for the People initiative,
right?
Because when we reach the people and the people know what the plan is, and we mobilize and we know the message and we vote,
right,
we win.
My brother. Thank you, sir. Now, we got 3 minutes with four people. Money, Power, and Love sounds like a Lox album. We love it. So why don't we start with Professor Crenshaw? Come on down.
So we have to recognize exactly how this attack is happening, and we have to inform our fight by realizing that how they've done this is by starting to go after a small thing, and then going after the next thing and the next thing and the next thing.
Right.
So when they came after critical race theory, a lot of people say, oh, well, I don't do that.
Right.
That's not about me. We said, look, this isn't about critical race theory.
Right.
This is about anything having to do with racial justice.
Right.
You're going to see really soon that they're not going to stop at a few academics. And surely that is exactly what has happened. So they've gone from critical race theory to going after black history. They've gone from black history to going after diversity. They've gone after diversity in higher education to diversity in business. Eventually, their objective is to erase all ability to talk about everything we talked about here.
Right.
So if you wonder what this is they're going after, if you wonder if they're coming after you, if you heard anything up here today that you thought, you know what, that's exactly right, if you heard about the fact that we don't get the same kind of capital, if you heard about the fact that we don't get access to grandfathering in, if you heard about all of these things and you say, that's what race consciousness tells us about our reality, then you are a critical race theorist. They are coming after you.
Yes.
So there's no pivoting. Okay. There's no running. We've got to stand up and fight. We've got to be informed. We've got to know what they're trying to take away from us. And check us out downstairs. We've got all of the books that they're trying to take away from you. If you see concretely what they're trying to take away, then you're going to be more prepared to fight it wherever you see it.
Thank you so much. All right, we got 1 minute left.
We have to reclaim the infrastructure.
That's right.
Education, electoral, political. And we have to stand back to back. That's why Samantha and I, Lawyers Committee, Black Economic Alliance, filed briefs to support the Fearless Fund in their lawsuit. That's why we're suing Trump and Patriot Front and the Oath Keepers.
Right.
We're not going to allow them to take this over. We're going to reclaim the infrastructure every step we can.
Thank you.
And we can't let the fact that they are loud, they are organized, and they are well-funded make us think that the people are behind them.
They're not.
Mm. We just did a national survey with the Harris Poll that found that 81% of Americans of all stripes think that corporate diversity should reflect the racial diversity of this country. 78% said companies should be taking active steps to increase their racial diversity. And this was in August. This is after the affirmative action case. This is when the Fearless Fund case is happening. And that included 75% of white Americans and 67% of Republicans. And what that tells us is that the American public is behind. Those who are bringing these attacks, they're the ones who are out of step. So they're going to come for all of us. It's going to take all of us. And all the people are behind us.
Really quickly. That was wonderful. And I would just say we need not just allies. We need activists that are non-black. Sometimes we are talking amongst ourselves. We have to use our dollars. We have to have the money. This man has between 770 million up to 1.5 billion backing him. He is unrelenting and will not stop. You cannot fight that without collective wealth.
All right.
Get money.
Sister Parsons, Sister Tweedy, Brother Hewitt, Sister Crenshaw, Brother Horsford, they're bold, they're brilliant, they're beautiful, they're creative, they're your people. Give it up for the Fantastic Five. All right, thank you. Give it up one more time for our version of The Temptations, The Supremes, and Martha Reeves and the Vandellas. Our second panel today is a discussion on democracy. So what's next? We'll talk about protecting the vote, securing fair representation, and ensuring the integrity of our elections. Finally, we'll take up the question raised in the title, what's our strategy and what are the most effective tactics to pursue it in the coming months and years to preserve and strengthen our democracy? To explore these topics, once again, we're blessed with an eminent group of experts and leaders in the field. To begin with, a member of the CBC, our ALC Gala co-chair, the delegate from the U.S. Virgin Islands, Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett. Still Brooklyn. Right. The chair of the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, representing the 7th District of Alabama, Princeton's proud graduate, Congresswoman Terry Sewell. She had to go vote. All right. We'll have more time for the other folk, and if she returns, we'll get her in. A community organizer and voting rights activist, the co-founder of Black Votes, Voters Matter, the great Latasha Brown. That's it, baby. A Tennessee state representative representing parts of Nashville, and a nationally recognized champion of racial justice, and a man from Vanderbilt University, what up, the Honorable Justin Jones. And finally, the chief policy officer of the Southern Poverty Law Center and SPLC Action Fund, LaShawn Warren. All right, let's get right to this. We had an extraordinary panel. We've got another extraordinary one for here in the second go round. So, Congresswoman Plaskett, we know that to get anything done in Congress, you're going to have to be extremely pragmatic. You've got to be able to compromise to a certain degree. and you must work with folks on the other side of the aisle. Can you give us words of advice for you, for your colleagues in Congress, and what words of hope do you have for those who have to fight those kind of internecine squabbles and battles as we look ahead for the work that still needs to be done?
Well, you really going deep on me. You do have to be pragmatic in Washington, and I think the genius and the ability of the president that we have now, President Biden, in getting such transformational legislation done in the last year and a half is because of that pragmatism and that ability to quietly bring together the desires and the needs of disparate groups and draw them together. We were able to do that under the leadership of Speaker Nancy Pelosi by understanding carrots. She understood, mother of five, carrots and sticks very well on how to bring people in their needs to be able to do that. Unfortunately, Professor, that's not something that's happening right now. And the leadership of the majority are unable to bring sticks to those and instead is giving them carrots. We're seeing that right now as you speak, where there was a vote yesterday, several held out of his majority, and a rule, which is a mechanism by which we're able to vote on major pieces of legislation, failed. So what did he do? He gave those five carrots. And so now what we are seeing is legislation that is in fact not pragmatic, not about the larger group, not about negotiation, but out of fear. And I think that ultimately his fear of losing speakership, his fear of, as you called him, the orange mirage, and his fear of that vocal group that were the insurrectionists, mm-hmm. is causing him to do what he's doing. Mm-hmm. So until he is removed, and the brother from Brooklyn put in, mm-hmm. I don't think we're going to see much use of pragmatism in this Congress.
Yeah, excellent, excellent distinctions there. And a critical word, because dealing with going across the aisle doesn't mean the surrender of principle.
That's right.
In deference to a kind of convenience and expediency. So thank you.
That's right.
For that. Sister Brown, last time I saw you, we were at the Vice President's crib spitting with Lil Wayne.
That's right.
Okay. But you are a renowned and legendary activists when it comes especially to voting. You're also running a tremendous program at Harvard that we had the opportunity to see up close. You're an extraordinary activist and agent of change. When it comes to voting, we see the retrenchment, we see the arguments between constitutional demands, states' rights, the gerrymandering, which is rigging the voting, state legislators, especially Republicans, who are redrawing a map mm-hmm. with strange geography. Mm-hmm. It can be overwhelming, especially to younger folk, young person like Brother Jones notwithstanding, you know, who think, my God, why even try? Because it's hooked up, it's rigged from the very beginning. Give us a word of insight from your extraordinary experiences about what we can do to strengthen the vote and to make sure that we use it in a way that is productive for our interests.
Oh, freedom. Mm. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom over me. And before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free.
Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to sing that because I want to bring the spirit of who we are in the room.
Because it ain't start with us. The fact that we are in this room right here is because there was somebody not only singing that song, but I want you to hear the words of the song. Before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave. I'm saying that because we really have to recognize that this isn't about centering the other folk. Right. We have to center ourselves and our power. And in this country, power is not something that is earned. You can work as hard as you want to. You've got to take power in this country. And I'm raising this because we're operating in this context, in this political context, like we're not fighting for our very lives. If there were brothers and sisters that literally were denied the right to read, to write, they were denied their own humanity, how in the world can we sit here and talk about how hard it is? Right? That we don't even have the luxury or the privilege to be able to say that coming from where our ancestors have come. And so I'm raising this because some way we have forgotten who we are. And so I am hoping in this moment that literally we recognize that it's never been just strategy that has freed black folks. It has been our spirit. It has been the spirit of resistance. It has been the spirit of us organizing. It has been the spirit of us radically reimagining something that we had never seen or felt before. It had been the spirit of us literally connecting with our people, recognizing that every single thing that I do, that at the end of the day, even a duck got enough sense to take care of his children, right? That we have to fight for our children. Like, if it's going to be me or you, it's going to be you, because it ain't going to be me. And so I'm saying this because it's that kind of fire that we actually got to tap into in our bodies, that we got to elevate our conversations, that we can't keep responding to what they want. I don't give a damn what they want. It is around what is it that we want for our people? What are the policies we need? How do we actually organize that? There are three things I'll say. One, black folk, you need to move to the South. I know y'all like New York and California, those places, but you need to move to the South. We got the numbers, we got the people, we got the spirit of resistance. The second thing is you need a political home. This is not the moment that, even though I'm a commentator on MSNBC, don't get your information just off on TV and opinions, that you have got to get a political home that you're a part of, whether that's the Lawyers Committee, whether that's NAACP, whether that's Black Voters Matter. You have to join or be a part of something that literally is going to help you shape the paradigm of how you're thinking about politics within the context of blackness. The third thing I'm going to say is we can give all these white folk money for our shoes, our clothes, all the things that we're doing. You need to have a budget, a political budget. Call it your freedom fund. So create a freedom fund so that you are actually supporting your liberation. How can you support those that are trying to oppress you, that you will not put money aside to fight for your own liberation? So those are three things that I think that we can do that are practical level things that we can do.
He's good to know. Yes, he is.
All right. Speak! My God. All right. That's the Reverend Dr. Latosha Brown, in case y'all did not know that. Fannie Lou Hamer meets Martin Luther King Jr. meets Ella Baker. Another tremendous and insightful person here, Brother Jones, Representative Jones. That great school of Vanderbilt, we produced some great people, and this is one of our greatest graduates. Now, you, along with Justin Pearson and another of your colleagues, the Tennessee Three, but you two most famously, stood in the gap, translated ideal to reality and theory to practice, and engaged the nation in an imaginative, if you will, tour of what democracy looks like. You stood for the truth. You weren't nasty or belligerent. You were insistent and strong. Talk to us about the necessity of continuing, as Sister Brown said, a tradition that we have inherited, and what it looks like in this generation as you extend that trajectory.
Definitely. Thank you so much for allowing me the platform to speak, not for myself, but for the people in Tennessee who are still fighting to protect kids and not guns, to fight for democracy, because we went to the well because democracy requires disruption. We faced a state legislature that was willing to ban books and ban history, and then even tried to ban black lawmakers. but they would not ban the assault weapons that are terrorizing our communities. We said, will you ban assault weapons? And they chose to stand in the tradition of their forefathers, their foreparents who founded the Klan in Pulaski, Tennessee, and decided to try and make a public exhibition, a spectacle, an expulsion, they called it. But what they really set into motion was the beginning of a process to expel that system of white supremacy from the people's house. I come here as the youngest black lawmaker because when they expelled us, they were trying to send a message to other young people, don't step out of your place. And there are members of my own caucus who said, go up there and apologize to them. And we said, they need to apologize to the people, to the families of that elementary school where those babies were killed. They need to apologize. And so what we are seeing now is a system in which I've told young people, we are going to these chambers not to make friends, but to make change. My first week in the legislature, I was in the elevator, had my suit, was excited to go to committee, and my welcome to the legislature was State Senator Jack Johnson out of nowhere just telling me, without me even talking to him, you know you're worthless and you don't belong here. We have members who this year, in 2023, said we should bring back hanging by a tree as a form of capital punishment. We see what we're up against. And so, again, democracy requires disruption. We went to the well of the House. We walked forward because our people were being pushed back. The young people were being pushed back. I pulled a megaphone out of my pocket because they shut off the microphone. They refused to see us as equal. And so every day I get in there, I want to remind them that I'm not here as your intern. I'm here as your colleague. I'm here to give voice to the most diverse district in Tennessee. And so if that means they're going to take a title, they can't take away our purpose of why we're there. They can't take away the wisdom of my mentors, people like Diane Nash, who said that power only shows itself when it has to. And so them expelling us shows that they were threatened by what we were doing and that we have power and that we need to change a system where in my state, 70% of the seats in the legislature were unchallenged in the last election. No one ran against these folks who've been there longer than I've been alive. We have a legislature who, before they expelled us, they broke our congressional district, one county, Nashville, into three congressional districts. And for the first time since the Civil War, we have Republican representation. They passed a law to cut our city council in half. And then they try to take away my constituents' voice at the state level. We see this as strategic. We see what is happening, that when they say we want to take this nation back, they're taking us back to a time we don't want to go to. But we know that we also stand in tradition, a tradition that says that you may have dominant authority in this house. You call yourself a supermajority, but you don't have ultimate authority. And it takes us realizing that we are not the minority party. We are the opposition party. We are the voice to check their power. We're there to be a speed bump to stop this madness of trying to drive our whole state off the cliff. Because to the white folks in Tennessee, I've told them once and I'll tell them again, we are fighting for your children too. Right. When we pass common sense gun laws, we're fighting for your children too. When we're fighting to expand Medicaid, we're fighting for your children too. When we're fighting for well-funded public schools, we're fighting for your children too.
Right. Amen.
And so I'll end by just saying this. I think that I've heard Southern segregationists had a saying, they said the South will rise again. And I come here as a witness to a different type of resurrection that says the South will rise anew. A new South is rising that is multiracial, multigenerational. And that is what we represent. And that is why they're fighting with everything in their being to stop us, but they can't stop what God has already claimed. There's something happening in the South, something happening in a city where young people rose up before to birth a movement. There would be no civil rights movement without Nashville. Let's be honest. And so I will say that there's a legacy of liberation once again rising in Nashville, and that we are a people of progress. Power to the people.
Amen. Amen. Get the spirit up in here now. Pass the plate. Thank you so much for that. Very powerful. And we need young people like this. And we need to support young people like this to make sure that our traditions remain alive. Thank you so much, Representative Jones. Sister Warren, here we are in the midst of an extraordinary assault upon American democracy. You know, they ask black people all the time about, it's always January 6th for us. Because it ain't never been the fact that white brothers and sisters of certain pedigree have not wowed it out and resisted the fundamental exercise of freedom and democracy. We saw what happened after enslavement with the 12 years officially of Reconstruction and then the redemptionist period that Professor Crenshaw spoke about. White supremacy has been weaponized. What can lawmakers do to deal with domestic terrorism, first of all, by acknowledging it existing, and it has been said, the greatest threat, finally, to American democracy, and given the extraordinarily important work that you do and the center that you represent does, what can we do to support those efforts?
Thank you for that question, and good morning, everyone. I'm so honored to be on this panel. I want to first thank Congresswoman Sewell and Horsford, and the president of this Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, Nicole Austin Hillary, for their extraordinary leadership, and the entire CBC delegation, because they hold the line for us every day.
Mm-hmm.
And they're in the fight for us every day. I want to begin by saying a few words about my organization. For over 50 years, we have been working to root out racial discrimination and to expose white supremacy and combat that throughout the country. It is still present and alive. If there's nothing else that January 6th taught us, that is that democracy is not a foregone conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
We have to fight for it.
Mm-hmm.
It is incumbent upon us to get in the fight, to expose nationalism, to expose white supremacists, and to do whatever we can to root it out and actually abolish it in its entirety. Now, there are a couple of things that I think is important as we look at this moment. One, the one thing that I think is incredibly important for us is to understand that in this democracy, everyone doesn't have equal access. We all don't have the power to vote equally, particularly black and brown people. And there are efforts afoot to make sure that our power is reduced, and we can't have that. Mm-hmm. And we have to know that we are in a fight.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I want to do is share with you the story of my aunt, because I think it speaks powerfully to the moment that I believe that we're in with respect to the crisis of our democracy.
Mm-hmm.
She is 80 years old, and she lives in Savannah, Georgia. And in the 2022 election, she decided she wanted to participate in this election. She has never missed an election. She's over 80 years old, and she struggles with arthritis. And because this election was so incredibly important to her, she said, I'm going to vote early. So she went to her polling place. And when she got there, the line was out the door and around the building.
Mm-hmm.
But the important point of this was that was not the general line. That was the line for seniors and people who needed assistance.
Mm.
She told me that there were young people who had to stand in place of seniors who were physically unable to stand in line for that long.
Mm.
She stood in line for over an hour in order to vote. Now, the question is, why in 2022 is there an 80-year-old woman having to stand in line for over an hour to vote? I'm so glad you asked that question. So in 2021, one of the things that the Georgia State Legislature did was they passed SB 202, and that law made it much more difficult for people to vote. In fact, what it did was it shrunk early voting and runoff elections. And that made the lines longer, which means that she had to stand in line. In this day and in this era, we should not have our seniors standing in line for 80 for at 80 years old, standing in line for an hour in order to vote. That is completely unacceptable.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the things that I think is incredibly important, and I'm so glad that we're having this conversation, is there is a through line. The same people who are working to oppress voting participation, who are passing this heinous laws. Georgia wasn't the only state. There were states across the South who were passing laws to make it more difficult to vote. And at the Southern Poverty Law Center, we know a little bit about discrimination down there. It is happening in every facet of American life. And it's important for us to not look at these kinds of situations in isolation. We have to connect the dots. It is not just voting. It's that the same people who are trying to oppress the right to vote are the same people who are going after diversity and inclusion. The same people who are challenging affirmative action. They're the same communities that are going after immigration. They are going after everything. And I think we as a people have to see the intersectionality of all of these issues. When CRT is attacked, we have to stand up. When we see that there are voter suppression laws, we have to stand up, and we cannot see them as isolated incidents. We have to work together, and only working together can we combat these issues.
Mm, excellent, excellent. Already, we've got a time limit here, so I want to give each of you a couple of minutes to just summarize for us the significant central thing that we can do to strengthen democracy for our people. And I'll start this way, and I know that Sister Brown already answered, so we'll put you last so you can add on to what you said. But I'll begin with Representative Plaskett. What is the central thing, a significant single thing that we can do to strengthen democracy for our people?
Well, I think it's summarized in so many of the words that I heard here. Fight, disruption, organized movement of disruption. I'll give you an example. As I said earlier, I sit on this new committee that was created by the members of the other side of the aisle, the Republicans, the Select Committee on the Weaponization of Government. And this committee's purpose is to do the groundwork for the dismantling of the actions of the Department of Justice, the FBI, to make people distrust our institutions, also to be a sounding board to determine if conspiracy theories, misinformation, catch hold with people. My job as the lead Democrat there, and you know, I have to thank Hakeem Jeffries for putting me in that position, because there's eight of us and most of them are more senior than me, but he asked me to be the lead is because I am willing to be disruptive. We have rules in the House about decorum and how we act. Individuals have their minute, their 5 minutes, and nobody interrupts them. But because we've decided we're going to be the truth squad, I don't allow their bullshit lies. Mm. So if they say something that's not truthful, I'm going to stop them. Nah. No, no, no. That's not the truth. That's a lie. It's not going to happen while I'm sitting right here next to you. Now, Jim Jordan don't like that.
Right.
My mere presence, and I make sure that I come in all 6 feet of me with 3-inch heels and stand over him before he sits down, right? Let him know you gonna sit first. But to be disruptive, to not accept it, to not play their game. We cannot continue to operate in the confines of the rules that they have constructed for us. For our behavior, we have got to set the rules ourselves. Because let me tell you, the people of the Virgin Islands don't have the right to vote for president. When we became part of the United States, territories were always eventually become a state. Wyoming, Montana, the others. When they started making territories with brown people and black people, they put up a law, Supreme Court ruling, by the same justice who wrote Plessy v. Ferguson, that said that the people who live in territories are alien races who cannot understand Anglo-Saxon principles of law. Mm. Therefore, we should not be able to vote. Never mind the fact that someone who comes from my island of St. Croix was Alexander Hamilton, who helped write that law, right? But if y'all don't keep your right to vote, we will never get a right to vote.
Right.
So we want to fight for you more than some of y'all want to fight for yourself.
Yes.
Disrupt.
Thank you.
Set your own rules.
All right. Yes. Bullshit, an ancient Greek term that means tomfoolery meets chicanery. Spoken like a true Brooklynite. And speaking of Brooklyn, the Reverend Dr. Al Sharpton has just joined us here. And the Reverend Dr. Mark Morial, the great leader of the Urban League, two of our great black leaders. We are, and American leaders, we're glad to have you. We got 3 minutes left. Let's turn to Representative Jones and Sister Warren. Tell us very briefly what it is, the single thing we can do to help democracy for our people. And then we'll end with Sister Brown.
I think one thing that we have to be alert to is to not fall for their tactics of deflection, deception, and distraction. This week, people were debating what people wear on the Senate floor. We're fighting for a democracy. We don't care about how people dress. And so we cannot fall for these distraction tactics. We have to recenter what is happening on the fact that we are facing authoritarianism in this nation. Because people can vote, but what we're seeing is this old strategy of once we're voted in, they are ousting lawmakers, as we saw in Florida with the state attorney, as we saw what happened in Tennessee. They're censuring them. In our house, they passed a new rule during special session. I see one of my colleagues here, and I was the only one who they enforced it against, where they can vote on the House floor to make you not speak for the rest of the session. And so they're instituting new rules to even once we're elected, they're suppressing the voice of democratically elected representatives. This is authoritarianism, and if it was happening anywhere else in the world, we would be condemning it. But it's happening right here, and so my challenge to the president and to this administration, come to the South and have a summit on democracy in the South before we go abroad. Let's talk about what's happening in our own nation, where people are attacking democracy and silencing the voice of the people. This is a real threat, and that's what is at stake, is will we have a democracy for those generations who are coming up after us? And that's why we have to fight with whatever we have. We have to vote, but we have to go to these chambers, as they did in my state, and shut these chambers down. We had mothers and teachers and clergy come to the Capitol, fill up the rotunda, sue the speaker over his rules where he said, you can't bring a piece of paper into committee, but you can bring a gun. Because what they're doing is instigating a civil war where they're making it easier, they're proliferating weapons of war on our street, and they're making it harder to vote our most powerful nonviolent means of social change. Think about what's going on. They want violence, and January 6th was their dress rehearsal, and we have to be alert to let them know that we know what's up and that we're not gonna fall for these tactics to deceive the people and to distract us, but we see with clear eyed, with moral clarity, and with fierce urgency that we have to act with boldness and do things out of the ordinary in such a time as this.
All right, we got a minute left for these two powerhouses. Yes, ma'am, weigh in.
Yes, okay, so I think it's important for people to recognize that all of these attacks, it's no accident that they're happening at a time when our country is most diverse. Mm-hmm. We need to keep that in the forefront of our mind. That is no accident. But there are three things. I know you said one, but there are three things that people can do. One is educate yourself.
Okay.
We need to educate ourselves because those who don't know their history are doomed to repeat it, and that can help inform how we move forward. The second is vote. But not only vote, hold the elected officials accountable. And then lastly, build. Mm. We don't have the luxury of just reacting to what other people are doing. We have to put out fire, so in one arm have our fire extinguisher and the other nails, hammer, and lumber to build the kind of world that will help our people not only survive but thrive.
Thank you. Excellent. Mr. Brown, take us on home.
It's not just about what they want, because I think sometimes we're too focused on what what the whoever the they is. It is a question of what it is that we want. And I ask people often to close their eyes and imagine what would America look like without racism. And I want you all to do that when you go home. Right? Many of us have never been asked that question. We have to use our radical reimagination. We're creative, y'all. Our creativity is not just for our entertainment or for other folks' entertainment. We have to be creative to think about what systems are going to serve us. For the first thing I did right was the day I started to fight. Keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize and radically reimagine the kind of America that we desire and that we deserve.
Amen. Give it up for Representative Plaskett, for Sister Brown, for Justin Jones, Representative, and for Sister Warren. God bless them. Give them all some mad love up in here this morning. Yeah. Finally this morning, hold on. We have another special message, and the messenger is well known to you all. To introduce him, I'll just quote what Mayor Eric Adams said a few days ago in presenting him with the key to the city of New York. Despite all of his successes, he has never forgotten where he came from, giving back to New York City, donating millions to underserved communities, and supporting aspiring black entrepreneurs. I thought I told you we weren't going to stop. I thought I told you we weren't going to stop. Sean Diddy Combs, welcome him to this rostrum.
Hello, good morning, everybody. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. How you doing, Tish? How's everybody doing? So many revolutionaries in here. The work that you do is so important, so important. You know, I'm on the other side of it, trying to come through the door of making sure we get economic fairness and equality in the fight that y'all fight for just all of us in as black people, and also just our overall community. We need y'all and we appreciate y'all. And I just wanted to come and say thank you. Thank you very much. And I look forward to talking about solutions and getting to solutions. I love what I'm hearing about disruption. It's important to disrupt and it's important to reimagine. God bless y'all and have a beautiful week.
Now, y'all don't just clap. We need everybody ready for battle. They're trying to stop black businesses. You know what's happening with the sisters in Atlanta. And Puffy won't talk about it, but y'all know I'm a disruptor. I'm going to talk about it. They are not doing him right in the spirits industry. Mark Morial and I are going to talk to y'all more about it when he's not there. But we've got to support our own. I've seen Puffy give away millions of dollars on the front line. Anytime we call them, when it's time for us to be on the front line for them, we shouldn't be apologetic. Am I right? So don't take a picture, make a picture. Let's get out there and go to war. I wasn't on the program, but I am the program.
He is the program.